Well, the first question we have is completely unrelated to the game, and that's, are you a coffee or tea person?
Actually, I'm both. I'm a morning coffee and evening tea person.
I can get behind that.
Yeah, same here. What's your favorite type of coffee and tea, I suppose?
Oh, I'm really not picky.
Really?
From anything from Senseo to, you know the Senseo, or is it the European thing?
It must be European. I mean,
like these pads, you know, instant pads. I really don't mind as long as it wakes me up. It's fine.
We literally just had a conversation right before you entered about just being picky about coffee. Do you have Starbucks where you're at?
Yeah.
Yeah, we were talking about how we're not, or at least I'm not a big Starbucks fan, and I know KB's not either.
Nope.
I think it's way too sweet, most of it.
Yes, I agree.
And my girlfriend actually used to work at Starbucks.
Oh, really?
So I got all this stuff for free. But it wasn't good for my health, this stuff.
Right, yeah. All right, so I guess you could start off by just kind of giving us a little background on you as a developer, and I guess the stepping stones that led you to making, I guess at the time, Project Stuffies, and then what turned into Woven.
Yeah, sure. You know that Woven is made with two companies, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So I'm Digital Forest. It's just my freelance name. Mm. So one man. And then we have Alter Ego Games, which are two people. So with the three of us, we're making Woven. And my past, it's quite a long, long thing. I've been doing this for 16 years, I think.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
Always as a freelancer, and sometimes with some part-time jobs, making small games, starting with games, Flash games, even before Flash, you know, Flash from websites. Mm-hmm. Even before that time, there was this thing called Director, which it's horrible, but mm-hmm. there was nothing else. And 15 years ago, one of my early games was called The Doozles, and that was actually the basis for Woven.
Oh, really?
Because it was a game about creatures that you could put on your website. You could let them grow, and when they were grown up, you could mix them, and then you could combine them to a new creature. And there was a sort of a battle chat box where you could put your creature in, and they would fight each other. And then if you had, the turtle shell from a turtle, then you had extra defense. And if you had the arms of a dragon or something, then you could do extra damage.
Oh my gosh, that sounds amazing.
So that was the original concept, actually. And that was just a one-time game that I made for a children's website.
Mm.
And that was quite popular. And just kept going, making other games. And when I was, I think it was 2011, a friend of mine said he wanted to make a game and invest in a team. And then we came up with using this concept, but then making it more current and more story-based. And we came up with the cute, cuddly toys.
Yeah.
So and it fitted somehow. You know, yeah, the body parts, changing it. It's not as nasty as if it's a toy than if it's a real creature. But we could never finish this thing. We had too much. Our goals were way too big, way too high, and we just built one sort of visual thing to just. There is actually on YouTube, you could find this thing if you would look for the Stuffies. You should find a video of the same elephant as we have for Woven, walking in a different environment than the demo. And that's the five-year-old version.
Oh, wow.
And this thing was my ultimate selling point for getting jobs. getting assignments. I always showed this video, and people were enthusiastic about the quality and the cuteness. So it's kept coming back in my life, you know?
Yeah, cuteness always sells.
Yeah. And last year, 2 years ago, I met the guys from Alter Ego Games.
Mm-hmm.
And I did some job, some little games for them, made some games for them. Because originally I'm a programmer. Now I'm only doing visual stuff, but originally I'm a programmer.
Mm-hmm.
They also loved this toy, this elephant toy. And then we decided, let's make this into a new thing. Mm-hmm. And we decided to really reset the whole thing, you know, like that is not my game and they add to it, but it's our game. So we reset it, everything, and it stayed, of course, the cuddly toy.
Yeah.
But they, Matthijs is a story writer. So we added the narration.
Yeah.
And Dominic is a programmer, but also user friendliness and this kind of area, you know. Mm. So he specialized on the controls, and together you get this Woven.
Yeah. Oh, wow. So Woven is technically it's been in the works for 15 yeah. years.
Yeah, at least the core concept,
right.
The core game mechanics is wow. very old. Yeah.
So did Glitch then come into the picture when you met the guys from Alter Ego?
Yeah.
Okay.
Glitch. There was in the Stuffy's version, so the 5-year-old version.
Mm-hmm.
There was talk about a steampunk robot kind of thing,
mm-hmm.
but it was more that the stuffed animals would go into some kind of a mad professor shop where you could recombine them. So there's like a machine that could recombine them, and we kept the robot thing, but we made it more like it's the opposite world. You know, you have two worlds. You have the stuffed animal world and you have the robot world.
Yeah,
which is still partly secret, of course, but you saw the ants, so you know that there are robots.
Right, and that's kind of what my next question was going to be, because you know, one of my favorite things about Woven is the whole concept of Glitch. He's really is a really cool, unique character, and I love the way that he's kind of like, he's not exactly the focal point of the story, but yet he technically is the one controlling, you know, the elephant. Because the Stuffy follows the lights wherever Glitch is pointing. So what can we expect is there anything that you can kind of hint as far as Glitch's story, what's going to happen? And you hinted that there's going to be a dark side with more metal creatures like Glitch. Can you hint at all?
Yeah. Well, I can say that the Glitch is, you saw the intro, you know, this mm-hmm. the bit scary part with where's he from? And he's actually the main storyline. So if you discover who Glitch is,
mm-hmm.
then you discover the story.
Okay.
Basically. Okay. So that's the main storyline will be discovering the past of Glitch and what he really is.
Okay.
And also discovering why there's metal objects there, metal creatures there.
Right.
So the story will be a bit more dark, but not dark like in horror movie dark or
right,
something.
Right, right.
But more dark as in there's, you know, like Neverending Story?
Yes, yeah.
Like there's some evil lurking.
Which scared me as a child, but you know,
yeah.
it could, I mean, so technically, if you look at it, it could be sort of horror depending on it, because that, I actually had two questions from my daughter, which, yeah. you know, I'm just going to come out and say is probably your biggest fan right now. She's 4 years old, and every single day she has been pretending to be Stuffy.
Glitch.
And she's got like a little stuffed animal firefly. She pretends to be Glitch. So she absolutely loves it. So she was actually like, you know, what is this dark side? Well, you know, what kind of creatures are there going to be? And then, her other question, I might as well just say it now. She said, do you like Pokemon? And can you please make a Pokemon mod? Well, I could pretty much. But I'd be a bad father if I didn't ask that question. So.
Yeah. It's I feel a bit ashamed that my Pokemon knowledge is not that big. I'm actually a little bit older than the Pokemon generation. Mm. And I of course I saw it. I know about it, and mm-hmm. I know what it's about. And actually, my two colleagues from Alter Ego, they both know Pokemon very well.
Okay.
But for me, it's just I just saw it on TV, you know. I was already past the cartoon watching, the daily cartoon watching thing.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I went more to the South Park area or this kind of.
Yeah, right.
A little bit different.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, but
so.
She...
If there will be a mod,
yeah,
I don't know if there will be a mod, but I want to make a promise to you mm-hmm. that if we make this this Kickstarter work, so if we make it, mm-hmm. that I will send you one of these gifts, which is a real stuffed animal.
Oh my goodness,
she would adore that.
Yeah. Oh my god,
actually one of the. One of the rewards, if you go to Kickstarter on Wednesday, you know, on Wednesday yeah. we start, and you will look through the reward list, around $75, mm-hmm. you will get one of these stuffed animals.
Oh my goodness, that is so cool.
Yeah, but if you somehow don't manage to, I don't know, I will just give you one, you know, I know,
that would...
I really loved your video the most of all the videos I've seen, and if she's such a fan, I would like to give her this thing.
She is. She's truly a big fan, and that would seriously put the biggest smile on her face. So thank you for that. And speaking of your Kickstarter, you know, as we're recording this, the 7th is your launch day, right?
Yes. Or,
okay. So as we're recording this, it's tomorrow is your big day. Yeah. How are you feeling at this moment? How are you guys feeling? Are you feeling anxious, nervous, excited?
I think everything at the same time. A bit weird yeah. in the stomach. I don't know if I'm getting sick or that I'm just nervous.
Yeah.
But it's mainly we're so busy with preparing it for that day that we don't really have time to comprehend what we get into, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
So we will just let it happen and just see what happens. And we have plans to switch our daily routine to more American time.
Okay, okay.
So we'll be working in the night.
Yeah.
But I think that's good because the main audience is American.
Right, right.
The Kickstarter audience.
Yeah. Does everybody get the demo, or do you have to become a backer to get it?
The demo is mm-hmm. will be free for everybody.
Okay. And are there any other cool things that the backers can get?
You can start with from one. Well, we have it in euros, our thing, because mm-hmm. we're Dutch, and we don't have a company in America, so we're not allowed to use dollars.
Okay.
So that's a bit of a disadvantage for us, but it's just the way it is.
Right.
So I will talk in euros, but it's about the same, I think. I
yeah.
think it's a bit.
It's a expensive. Little bit different, but yeah. you know, people can do the. We have Google for the conversions.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think it's 89. About... Yeah, 89 euros is a U.S. dollar currently, as
okay.
of recording.
Okay. So it's not that far.
10% difference, give or take. Yeah, not too bad. Yeah.
From 1 euro, you can already pledge, and that will just be that you get your name mentioned. And I think from around 15 euros, you will get the game.
Okay.
And then you're going up to around 70, you will get physical things like the stuffed animal. So before that, you will get things like wallpapers and an art book.
Oh, wow.
Concept art. Actually, if you pledge 5,000, mm-hmm. which is the maximum, then you will get really a lot of stuff. You will get a handcrafted stuffed animal, which only five in the world will ever be made.
Oh, wow.
And they're made by a special artist who makes these vintage stuffed animals.
Oh, wow.
And you will get a glitch in bronze. So really melted. Yeah, I don't know how you say this in English, but you know, like a really like yeah. a smith. A smith can make these things.
Right.
And you will get the spider 3D printed. And you will get three of these stuffed animals, of the bigger ones, which are the you know, the 75 euro ones.
Mm-hmm.
A whole bunch of stuff.
Wow.
CD, audio tracks. We really have a huge amount of gifts.
That is, I wish I had 5,000 euros.
That's well, it's just only $5,612.50 US.
So. Oh, yeah. Well, I've got that in my pocket. I can, you know.
Excellent. Is this your first experience with Kickstarter, or have you done stuff on Kickstarter before?
No, it's completely new for me.
Okay.
Of course, I know about Kickstarter, and I've supported some, backed some Kickstarters. But doing this, this is a completely new, new thing for me. For all of us, actually.
Oh, wow.
And we know some people who did a successful Kickstarter, and we talked to these guys, asked for advice, and everybody says, don't do it. It's the first thing they say.
Really?
And then they say, if you have to do it, be prepared to be in a nightmare mode for a month, because you will not sleep. You will have to do everything that you as a developer are not used to doing, like doing interviews, keeping social media running, this kind of stuff. And if you know the gaming industry a little bit, that's the main issue of especially indie companies. Promotion is never part of the plan.
Right.
If people don't know about it, they cannot buy it because they don't know what it's in.
Yep.
So. It's actually the worst thing you can not take serious.
Oh, wow.
We've been spending the last 3 months full-time, three people, only Kickstarter. Only preparing this thing.
And you've got distribution set up and all the for the physical goods and stuff.
Yes.
Set up in a place. Okay.
And we have to calculate, imagine that 90% happens to be Japanese, you know, and we have to send it to Japan, all of it. You have to calculate if we will still be successful as if we get that amount of costs, extra costs.
Wow, yeah.
Because I followed some Kickstarter things where they met their goals but didn't calculate well enough and then actually lost money on Kickstarter because of it or failed.
Yeah, exactly. So we try to keep it around 10%, that we have 10% costs. That's only the physical stuff, you know, the 10%. And then you have taxes, then you have the Kickstarter itself, who wants a percentage.
Yeah.
So it all adds up, and it adds up to that, at least here in Holland, we get around 50% of what we wanted to get.
Okay.
Yeah, so I know a lot of people see Kickstarter and like, oh, they raised $1 million. I'm like, yeah, but they didn't get $1 million. Yeah,
exactly. They got half a million.
If they're lucky, yes. So
And all the work after that, because shipping it to everybody will take you a month by packaging everything.
How has Steam helped you? Because I know you guys got greenlit last month, right? On Steam?
Yes. Around a month ago. I think a bit more.
Okay. Well, you know, Steam is, a godsend when it comes to indie gamers and stuff, or indie game developers. How was that process for you, being, you know, going on Steam Greenlight?
That was fantastic, I would say, because I still don't get it, because it took us a week.
We were
looking up the statistics because we needed green light to happen, because
the main
reason to get green light, actually at the moment the only reason to get green light would be that you have Steam keys that you can send out.
Okay.
And if you have Steam keys, you can send it to everybody and make promotion. So that was our main goal. And then we looked up the average time it takes to get through green light, and it's around 1.5 to 2 months, the average.
Mm-hmm.
And so in 1 week we got it, and we don't know why, and we don't know how, but it happened. So we didn't really have a bad experience with that.
Okay, wow.
Yeah, it just went very smooth.
Because I've heard some nightmare stories with, you know, Steam Greenlight. Not because of Steam, just the stress involved and, you know, developers obsessing, you know, checking it. And people can be very harsh. I think we all know that. They can be very harsh on Steam. I mean, I've seen some really awesome games that I believed in just not get noticed because of people's negative comments, you know. So that's actually amazing to hear how fast you were greenlit. That is...
Yeah, and how positive the people were. Because there were hardly any negative things there.
Oh, that's awesome. Hopefully there that's a taste of things to come, you know.
Yeah, that's actually our biggest energy booster. How do you call this? The biggest...
like motivator? Get,
yeah, motivator. Mm-hmm. Because everybody has been so positive about it.
And I hate to say my take on a lot of Steam greenlight games that are greenlit are to me subjectively bad,
right?
And objectively, like, they're actually broken and mm-hmm. they're somehow greenlit and they're asking for money. So for me, it's like, oh, it was greenlit. To me, that when it first came out was like an amazing thing. Now it's like, that doesn't really mean anything.
Yeah.
Right.
But the fact that you're getting so many positive reviews is definitely a good sign. So,
yeah, that's amazing. Did you have stuffed animals growing up? Is that kind of where, I mean, I know that the game's been pretty much 15 years in the making, the core of the game. But did you have any stuffed animals growing up? And if so, did you have one that was your favorite?
I did have some. It's going to be a boring answer, like the Pokemon answer.
Yeah, yeah.
I did have some, but it's not really a big, I don't have a big memory of this. I know that my brother had a lot of stuffed animals, but I was more the Lego kind of guy.
Yeah.
And I later it became Transformers, this kind of thing.
Yes.
But that's my youth, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
My youth is Transformers, He-Man. Maybe you know this. Mm-hmm.
Oh yes.
Yeah. I had some of these dolls.
You know.
I also liked miniature stuff, so I did like all these little, like, I sometimes had like a little puppet or something, a little robot or little things, and I still have them around my desk, you know, like these little sort of cute toys.
Yep, I actually have one too. That's, you know, I'm just like you. I didn't have really stuffed animals that I was attached to as a kid. I had this really weird, it was a Halloween decoration, I think, when I was a kid. It's like this bendable miniature skeleton that just has like bendy arms, you know, it's like wires inside of it and it's wrapped in like rubber.
Yeah, so you can put it in any shape.
Yep, and I named him Michael, and I still have him. He's wrapped around my lamp on my desk right now.
That's great.
And, you know, like my daughter, she doesn't, I mean, she plays with stuffed animals, like, for pretending sakes, but she... You know, a lot of kids have security blankets or like blankies and teddy bears. And she has these throw pillows that go on a couch, and she carries them around everywhere. And if she doesn't have her pillows with her, you know, she it's almost like her world is falling apart. I asked the question because, you know, there's when I was playing the game, I mean, you could sense some sort of childhood connection, childhood passion behind it, you know. I felt instantly connected as soon as the game started. So I was just wondering if you had some sort of inspiration for the elephant, or, you know, anything that that may have came from your creativity from your childhood that would have inspired that.
Yeah, I think it's not really my childhood necessarily. It's more the there are some things that I really like. And they're all for different reasons.
Mm-hmm.
And they're mainly movies or series that I used to watch.
Right.
They gave me this feeling. And one of them is Peter Pan. Mm. There was a cartoon of that, which was a really... Maybe you guys, I don't know if anyone...
The Disney one or the animated series, the television series?
The animated series.
Yep, I watched that as a kid too. Yep.
Yeah, I really liked that atmosphere of freedom and like everything has a playful layer in it, you know, like
a sense of wonder, a sense of adventure.
Yes, and even the bad guys are somehow it's not that bad, but part of the adventure,
right.
You know?
Yeah.
And I like that thing. I also like Alice in Wonderland because it's like this twisted, like you don't know what to expect kind of
right,
thing.
Right, yep.
And was... I like animes. You know, maybe you know One Piece? One of you guys?
I don't know One Piece. I'm
aware of it. I haven't watched it yet.
Yeah.
It's this this pirate concept, you know, bunch of pirates. Mm-hmm. But it's really a weird series because it has this feel-good atmosphere.
Yeah.
And the series itself is a bit ridiculous, but I still like it because of this feel good.
Yeah.
You know, the same with some games. You have some of these games. I think World of Warcraft is one of them.
Yeah.
Where you log in for the reason that you want to be in the world.
Right.
You not necessarily know what you're gonna do yet, but you just want to be there.
Yep.
And this is what I wanted to, the feel I wanted to create.
Well, I could say that it's definitely there, and I'm so excited to see what the finished product is going to be.
Yeah, same for us. We have a long way to go to make it, and it also depends, of course, on how many how do you call it, stretch goals we get on Kickstarter.
Mm-hmm.
Because if we get exactly the amount we need, then we will make the minimal version, I would say.
Yeah.
But we, of course, we wanted to do much more.
Mm-hmm.
And the more creatures we can make, the more combinations you can make. So
exactly.
I think that will also be nice, that people can find their favorite animal and create their favorite combination.
And do you have a turnaround time estimated, at least, based on, or you have to wait till the Kickstarter results are in?
We hope to create it in around a year time, and depending, of course, again on the stretch goals, and then the stretch goals will decide if we have to hire more people, maybe,
right.
Or that we need more time.
Well, if you need any beta testers, I'm sure Buddha Kitty, his daughter, would love to.
yeah.
Oh, I actually have a question for you guys. What do you think are target audiences for this game?
Oh wow. You know, if just looking at the game without even playing it, I would have assumed that it was for a younger demographic. But like I was saying, when I played it, I think it actually targets more towards, you know, our generation. People that grew up with those action figures and those toys and that sense of wonder and imagination, but it can also reach people, you know, like my four-year-old daughter.
We didn't really have a concrete plan. We didn't focus on the target audience necessarily, but we wanted to make a game that was a sort of a family game.
Right,
not really like that the family should play it, but that all generations could find something in it.
Well, I think that you are accomplishing that. I mean, what do you think, KB and Jay?
Well, I look at it like Disney movies, where if you make a movie for kids, only kids will like it.
Right.
Adults will despise it because it's stupid. Right. It's because, not that kids like stupid things, but, you know, if it's made with that in mind, it can come across that way. If you make a really good, you know, movie, in that case, game in this case, it can appeal to everybody. Personally, like, I went into this having not played it. I watched a little bit of BuddhaCat's video. That was it, because I wanted to have, like, you know, no concept of what was going on to make sure we could, you know, ask as a person who has seen nothing about the game yet.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my take on it, is just I've seen a little bit of the gameplay and the website, and that's it. And that's why I'm trying to ask questions based on that perspective.
Yeah. I think that's exactly what we try to achieve. Game or like a movie like Shrek, something like that.
Right, right.
Yep.
Like, you have the everybody enjoys it for a different reason.
Yep. That's...
And I think the grown-ups have a sort of a nostalgic.
It's a great
thing, maybe.
It's a great not analogy, but like comparison, like Pixar movies, where kids. I mean, kids just they're hypnotized by it. I mean, there's just something magical about those movies. And then at the same time, I watched Inside Out in theaters with my daughter, And, you know, my daughter was, like, just hypnotized by all the colors and the story. And my wife and I are just bawling. We're just, like, yeah. crying our eyes out because of the story of, like, this little girl growing up, you know. And I think it's exactly, you hit the nail right on the head that you are making something that could appeal to kids for a certain reason, and it could also appeal to the adults for another reason, and two entirely different reasons, and then you can also meet in the middle. It's a very hard thing to do.
And it's also our biggest, it was one of our biggest issues, you know. Yeah. People always, in the beginning especially, when we didn't have the demo, they were all asking like, they knew that it was a children's thing. So they didn't even ask, they just said, oh, but you're making it for children, so why would I test it? You know, right. Why would I play this? And it was a big concern for us, also because the Kickstarter community is not really a children place.
Right.
So we were a bit afraid, like, actually the darker side we added more because of this reason. We wanted to give some tension, you know, yes. give something to look forward to for the people who think like, oh, this is just some colorful candy world or something, you know?
Mm-hmm. You know, and I was actually going to say that, like, when I, right before I played it, you know, I saw a little bit of gameplay from a friend of mine, hashtag Corey Dean, and I was going through your website, and I saw that, it was that picture, I'm trying to think of what it looked like, but it had the spider, you know.
Oh, yeah. And the spider was wrapping these, yeah.
And that, and it instantly changed my perspective. Because like I told you, when I looked at it, I was like, it might be a children's game. But I'm a very bubbly person anyway, you know. Like, I feel like I live in that world anyway. It was just like, yeah. you know.
Same as me, actually.
Yeah, it's just a sense of wonder. Just like, I like to see the good in everything. So the game would have appealed to me anyway. However, I saw the spider image and it kind of changed my perspective, going, you know, there's more to this. There's more to this story. And yeah, I think you guys have accomplished that. And I, like I said, I can't wait to see the finished product.
It's really so bizarre for us doing this. Three of us, and just this is the only game I think that we all three are going with pure passion, you know.
Yeah.
That's our main drive for what we add and why we add it,
right?
You know? So we add stuff not for some client who wants something, or for some target audience who we think like, oh, this will please the audience or something. We really created, does it fit to what we think Woven is?
Right.
And I think that somehow that you can see that as a player. Yeah.
You can. You really, really can. And I feel like in the indie game community, one of the biggest and one of the most important things for indie game enthusiasts, indie game players, you know, people like me, one of the biggest things is I feel like I have to respect the developer going in, you know. Like, I feel like there has to be some form of respect there going in, you know. The kind of like what KB was saying earlier, you see these games getting greenlit that are technically indie games, but they're either broken or they're just, you know, made on some sort of template on whatever engine. Yeah. Pick one out of a hat.
Yeah.
But you go into an indie game feeling that form of respect, and you know, that's what you guys, that's what I have for you guys. You know, just like you said, you guys, this game is fueled by your passion, and it's there, it's apparent, you know. And
usually for me, I can tell within like about 30 seconds of watching footage, is this like just someone trying to make a quick buck, or do they actually want to make a really good game?
Exactly.
And honestly, on seeing his play of it, this is three people that made this?
Yep.
You and two other people, that's it?
Well, us three, we're making it, and we got an audio guy.
Okay.
So that's a fourth person, and we've got the narration, the voice actress.
Okay, so yeah, but still, yeah. So the whole crew is five people. It does not seem that way. This seems like it's from, you know, not to be insulting, and take this as a compliment. It seems like it's from a much larger studio, from what I saw.
Right.
Of a lot more people working on it, and yeah, but it's so I'm very impressed by that.
Yeah.
No, that's great to hear. And it's also, I can't take it differently than as a compliment, because for us, it's just, we still have the deadlines, you know, even though we want to make the game in any, in every way, polished in a way, we can't do that.
Yeah.
There's so much. So, so everything that we're, if we play the game, we see so much stuff that, oh, why aren't these mushrooms glowing when you look at them? And why aren't the, you know, why aren't the fish jumping out of the water and this kind of stuff?
Yeah.
Because we wanted to add all these things, but you just have all these deadlines with the Kickstarter.
Yep.
So we hope that we get some rest after that, and then we can make a, make an estimation of, okay, this is how much time we need, this is what our budget is, and then add all the good stuff and polish the stuff that we think is now a bit wonky. Like the levels are quite a lot of time is put into the level mm-hmm. design, mm-hmm. but still, if you look at how the textures blend, sometimes it's just for us, at least, it's a brush. You know, we put a brush over that, and the gradients, this kind of, I don't know.
No, I mean, it's kind of like...
Actually, I shouldn't talk it down, because I'm really proud of what we made.
Yeah, I was just about to say, like, you know, it's kind of like with songwriters. I don't know what other analogy to use, but, you know, they notice every... Like, I'm saying this because, you know, I am a musician. When I used to play live, I used to notice all these mistakes I made. You know, like I was pitchy here, or I missed a note here, or the drummer dropped his sticks, or like whatever, you know. And I would talk to my friends afterward. You know, I'd be so angry at myself or disappointed, and they'd be like, "What are you talking about?" Because they, you know, they don't hear that. You know, it's just like they don't see the lack of gradients or the lack of whatever, you know, that you think is going wrong in your game. Yeah. I think most people see a beautiful, a colorful world fueled by, you know, a team of developers who are extremely passionate about what they're doing, and, you know, an extremely unique and original story with lovable characters, and I think people are going to love it. I really, really do.
Yeah. Wow. I hope so. Sorry, I'm overwhelmed by your compliments.
Oh. Well, I want to thank you so much for talking with us. I mean, this is huge to us. You're our first, guest to be interviewed by us. And thank you so much. I really, really appreciate it.
Yeah, it was great. I think this way you're approaching this, like this way of interviewing, is also really good.
Well, thank
you. The coffee, take a cup of coffee and let's just chat.
Right. Yep. Thank you so much. Thank you. Yeah.